Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for joining us. We will be talking today about European solidarity in times of crisis. And we will be discussing the different features and different elements of European solidarity. European solidarity being at the core of every European policy, basically. It's the raison d'être of European integration. You find it everywhere. You find it in agriculture, of course, in the EU budget, the Corona recovery plan, in health issues like the joint vaccine procurement. You find it, of course, in structural policy, cohesion policy. You find it when countries try to help each other in times of natural disasters. So European solidarity is really always there, but there's a lot of tension as well, because the way European solidarity is perceived looks very different between Cyprus and Ireland, or between Poland and Spain. And I think this is something that we want to talk about today. We want to look at European solidarity through the national lenses. And I would like to do that with a very interesting lineup of people, which I would like to welcome very much. Let me start by welcoming Catharina Sorensen from Denmark. Hi, Catharina. Good to have you.
Paul, glad to be here.
Thank you for joining us. Catharina is the deputy director of the think tank EUROPA in Denmark. It's good to have you. Let me also welcome Ignacio Molina from Madrid.
Hello. Hello, Peter, Paul. Thank you for inviting me to this new session of the book. It's a great pleasure to be with Catharina and Peter, of course.
Well, thank you for joining us, Ignacio. He works as a senior analyst at the Royal Elcano Institute in Spain. And he's also a university teacher at the Autonomous University in Madrid, which is actually the place I spent my Erasmus year and I wrote my thesis some 24 years ago. So I have very good memories. Let me also welcome now Evelyn Regner, who has just joined us. Hi, Evelyn. Thank you for joining us. We've just started to present our lineup of people. Evelyn is a member of the European Parliament. She joined the European Parliament in 2009. And before that, she spent some 10 years representing the Austrian Trade Union, also in Brussels. So she's been a EU parliamentarian for quite some time. And since 2019, she's also chairing the Committee on Women's Rights and Gender Equality. Thank you for joining us, Evelyn. Thank you for being with us. Let me also welcome Petr Kartochvil.
Hello.
From the Czech Republic. Hello. Hi, Petr.
Hello.
Petr is a senior researcher of the Center for International Relations in the Czech Republic in Prague. Petr, thank you for being here with us. Now, the basis, in fact, for our discussion is a book which we're going to publish in December. The book is called European Solidarity and the Future of Europe, Views from the Capitals. Catharina, Ignacio, and Petr also contributed to that book. And the book is a collection, in fact, a collection of 41 essays from 41 analysts from 41 different countries. So it's 27 EU countries, plus countries like Iceland, Norway, Switzerland, Turkey, Ukraine, Georgia, or the countries of the Western Balkan. And they all take a look on European solidarity through their national lenses. How is European solidarity perceived and seen in their countries? What are the pros and cons? Are we more on the receiving side, or are we more providing European solidarity? What is the state of play here? And I think getting an overall view of what countries think and what the public thinks on European solidarity, in fact, improves our understanding very much and our dialogue and communication with others, which is actually essential for efficient and successful European policies, I may say so. And this book, in fact, is not a scientific textbook. You won't find footnotes in there. It is more of a very exciting thriller, I would say. It is a guidebook which takes the reader on a journey through the political European landscapes, the differences, the diversity, the variety of thinking because of geopolitical, historical, cultural differences, which are actually the very value added of European integration, if you can actually leverage it to a positive result. That's what the book is all about. Maybe we can just see the cover as a teaser. The book is actually published within the TEPSA network. TEPSA stands for the Trans-European Policy Studies Association. And as we are speaking, we will be having 41 talks in 41 different countries. We will see the cover whenever it's ready. Just put it in onto the screen. But over the next 60 minutes, what we want to do is we want to discuss the different elements and perceptions of European solidarity. And I would like to start with the Austrian member of the European Parliament, Evelyn. You and your work, actually, you have to do with European solidarity on a daily basis, no? Equality issues, social issues, the question of gender solidarity is very close to your heart, but you also work very much on tax issues. So the financial solidarity is very close to your work. Now, if you take a step back and look at all the issues that you have to deal with at the moment, from your point of view, what is the state of play of European solidarity? Where do you see tensions? And where do you see actually a value added where countries reach a positive outcome together?
So I see an overall danger. I mean, we have so many influences from outside, be it, I don't know, from Russia, from the US, be it capital, be it even groups like Ordo Iuris, who put money, energy into it in splitting the society as such. And of course, this is nothing that is only a matter of the European Union. It's taking place all over the world, but we are exposed to that. Elements splitting the society, that the younger generation is more or less put as a counterpart to the elder generation when we talk about climate change. Men against women when we talk about the Istanbul Convention. Northern countries versus southern countries within the European Union when we talk about the budget. I mean, it could go on and on, go on. I think everybody of you has a long list on all these issues. So we're living in a European Union that has to deal on a daily basis, that you just look around, and now even in families when talking about the vaccines, who in my friends group is in favor of a mandatory vaccination, who is against? And this is all crazy. No state in the world can be sovereign if not members are working together and bridging those gaps. No society can work, no European Union can work if you have the North versus the South and the women against the men and the younger against the older. This is all crazy. And therefore, I don't just see one issue, because we're amidst this whole way of splitting the society. And as a conclusion, when we just have this glasses Ivan Kaste was putting on, being so astonished when he wrote about Europe, that it happened so, no, not astonished because of his Eastern and Central European past. It happened so quickly that after a period of splitting and splitting and splitting a society, you have the full disintegration. And then it comes like this. Then it looks like it's happening so quickly, but of course it's not happening quickly because it takes a long while. And it's great. And therefore my answer to your question is, solidarity, something like a glue. We can do something against being ill when you just make a general illness insurance for all, whether the poor and the rich and the elder and the young in there, because solidarity then is the glue. And the European Union cannot only be a glue, the European Union sticking to the values and principles of this, what is written in the EU treaties, is a glue. And I'm absolutely convinced, especially right now during Corona and also during the financial crisis when we're debating like hell, we proved already. I mean, it's really a debate and we're struggling and it's not perfect and it's sometimes terrible. But there is a glue of solidarity that the countries who are in a stronger financial position support those who are in a weaker position, that during the Corona crisis, when putting our forces together, we can do something and we do it. We do it millions times better than we do it if we would do it if we are not together. And therefore, I just see the challenge. We are in the midst of it in everything. So somehow now it's the democracy that is stake. It's the climate at stake. And it only works if we're sticking together. And therefore, I just don't put out one element. Yes. Companies also have to do their solidarity towards the society, not only using the good infrastructure, but also giving their contribution back in order to allow this infrastructure. So everything, so energy, streets, schools, quality of life.
I think it was even Grashchev who talked about the European integration as a life insurance in the context that you can actually criticize and be as tough as you want towards the European integration, towards European, the European Union, which you yourself are the European Union. Because if you don't leave it, it's what you say, it's this life insurance and glue that keeps everything together. But if we're not careful enough, I mean, this is all not naturally given. If we're not careful enough, it can easily break as well. Because you've mentioned this one vis-a-vis the other, one against the other. That's also what we see very much if we read through the collection of contributions in the book, because the definition of solidarity is very, very different. I mean, Ireland, for example, on the one hand, has experienced an upgrade of solidarity in the Brexit negotiations, where the 26 held together when negotiating, or the 27 supporting Ireland. But on the other hand, when it comes to taxes or the Schengen area, the Irish position is a very different one. So you can actually go from one country to the next and look at the differences in their approach to solidarity. Because you've mentioned generational solidarity. Let me just say that I'm very glad that I can actually chair this panel from my daughter's room, because she has the best internet. So don't be surprised if you see some weird things up there in the bookshelves. So that, at least at home, the generational solidarity really works. But let me move on and ask Catharina. I mean, Denmark is a very interesting case in point, of course. Together with Austria, we form the group of frugal solidarity countries somehow. And Denmark, as you write yourself, is very often accused of lacking solidarity. What is your assessment at the moment while we are in the midst of the Corona crisis? Is this still the case? Is Denmark still a very inward looking country in that respective, or is this criticism badly placed?
Thanks, Paul. Well, I think there are some different layers in this. And I think it is correct that Denmark, in the history of its EU membership, has always had a need to somehow, an odd need to show that there are limits to how far we go. So we are the country with the most EU opt-outs. We definitely are very happy to be out of any migration solidarity. We are out of the euro, so we did not take part in the help to Greece after the financial crisis. And there are many examples of somehow us keeping an arm's length. But at the same time, as you mentioned, there was the Corona crisis. We had a very, very internally traumatic experience in Denmark, having tried to help Italy by sending some ventilators, but then it proved that these ventilators were broken when they arrived. So Italy said no to them, and I think that drew some headlines and really just showed that we seem to be doing solidarity with our left hands. We did not really mean it. The Prime Minister has also gained a reputation, not just for the frugal alliance with Austria and Sweden and the Netherlands, but also for her vaccine trip to Israel. I don't know if all of you heard about it, but in the middle of the big blame game going on in the spring earlier this year, the Prime Minister decided to go to Israel to say maybe we can get a partnership here outside of the...
She went there together with an Austrian friend.
That's right. That was still the now out of politics former Chancellor Kurz.
So yeah, he just resigned today, this morning.
Exactly, yeah. I think we've always, at least we haven't done much to hide that we want to keep an arm's length to the rest of Europe. And I think it's also, I mean, it's never been perceived as a give and take relationship when you talk about solidarity. It's always being seen as something that others might ask of Denmark, and not something we would ever be likely to receive. We've never actually triggered the EU's crisis response mechanism ourselves. I don't think there is a feeling that we why would we ever need, why would we ever be on the needing end of solidarity? That of course might happen, but the sense among Danes is very much that this is not needed for being integrated in the EU. Danes are very, very strongly supporters of EU membership. It has nothing to do with all these stories about keeping a distance. I think in terms of support for membership, feeling of benefit from the EU, feeling our voices being heard in the EU, the Danes are actually among the number one supporters in the EU. So it's nothing to do with feeling that we need to agree on everything or have a shared identity. We're quite happy with the EU and are also willing to pay the share of the budget, but we don't want we don't expect that there has to be a strong, thick layer of shared identity or solidarity.
But on the other hand, you do have a series of opt-outs from the Euro, from defense, from justice and home affairs, which includes the issue of migration. And I was wondering, has the Brexit or has the joint vaccine procurement changed anything in the political approach to European solidarity in Denmark?
Well, after the Brexit referendum, public support for the EU has increased. So I think there is a stronger sense that Europe is needed among the Danes than there was before Brexit, where the idea of leaving the EU was often heard in different political parties. That stopped. If you look at the political level, I think there is also a strong sense that we need to stick to the other member states in the approach to Brexit. Denmark has previously aligned itself very strongly with the UK. Now that's completely not the case anymore. We are fully behind the EU line on Brexit. So I think there's been a show of, you may call it solidarity, or at least agreement on the common line in the EU after Brexit. So Brexit at the moment has only contributed to a stronger sense of the need for Europe in Denmark.
And the joint procurement of vaccines, has that changed anything? Has that a positive connotation?
As I mentioned, the Prime Minister somehow at least did not recognize so much the importance of the joint EU vaccine scheme by her Israel visit, and also by suddenly launching an idea that Denmark should build a vaccine factory itself. So we have no history of having a vaccine production, and suddenly she wanted to have a vaccine factory. It came out that this factory should supply vaccines to Danes first. I think there was a call from the EU. It's not official, but that, you know, that's not really what you can do. So now it's instead turned into state aid for some of our medicinal companies that can produce more, try to develop more COVID vaccines themselves. But there's been very little recognition of the EU in the whole corona process. All the press conferences that's been held by the Prime Minister, I don't think she's mentioned the word Europe or EU at all. At least it's been very, very few references to what's happened south of the border.
Well, that sounds quite familiar to an Austrian. Let me move over to you, Petr. Czech Republic, you're writing in your piece about denied solidarity in the Czech Republic. European solidarity with a negative connotation as something which is perceived paternalistic and the tool of division, something from the EU old elites. Where does that come from? And by the way, I mean, you're going to have a new government very, very soon. Is there any change here taking place?
Well, yeah, interesting questions. Thank you for having me again and being in this great lineup of people. And in fact, what Katarina was talking about is eerily familiar to a Czech ear, because some of the things she described are very similar to what you would hear in the Czech Republic from the political class as well. But perhaps connecting your questions to the more general thing Evelyn Regner mentioned, because I think that is an interesting starting point. On the one hand, we have had a series of crises that all show that the nation state simply is not enough, right? The climate change, the coronavirus, even the Eurozone crisis, energy, all these show that the state itself cannot simply provide or secure the needs of its citizens at our times, right? But the paradox lies in the, you know, in the strange situation that in spite of this, and I think there is generally more or less a consensus among political scientists that this is the case, that we are beyond the nation state, at least in some policy areas. But at the same time, what you see, especially in Central Europe, in not only in the Czech Republic, but also in Poland, Hungary, elsewhere, is a kind of renationalization of politics, which has been extremely popular with the public, right? And that is, I think, the big challenge. On the one hand, the realization of us experts and analysts that this cannot go on, that it doesn't work, and still the overwhelming support by the public, at least in the region, but I'm sure it also may be similar elsewhere, for the national project, right? Or even stronger support than it used to be the case 10 or 15 years ago, or, you know, in the 1990s. And this, I think, is the big question. And therein comes the discussion about solidarity. So how solidarity is seen is derived, I believe, from the way where we perceive the, you know, our own, who we are, what the national or what our collective identity is. And to link that to your questions, about solidarity, I think that if we look at what I'm talking about the Czech case, but I think it would be similar in the Slovak or Polish or Hungarian case, the overall argument would be framed very similarly as Katarina described. So there is our own return to Europe, which is based on our being European. We do not have to become more European than we are. That would be the dominant narrative. We are doing well economically, we are growing, so that's the narrative. So when somebody comes with a, and that's important, with a moral argument, right? Solidarity is not about quid pro quo, it's not about benefits, it's about moral appeals. You should help others because it's good, right? Not because it is useful or beneficial for you, it's good. So it's a moral appeal. So in other words, it kind of says that if you are not European or moral enough, you should adopt European values of solidarity. And this clashes head on the dominant national narrative of the country, which simply sees itself as being European, as representing European values. So the result of that is exactly what you mentioned at the beginning, that solidarity then is seen mainly as a stick used by a weapon, rhetorical weapon, used by others, the European Commission or Germany or anybody else, used against these countries when they do not comply with the preferred vision by the big and powerful, right? Of course, this is just one narrative used very much by the populist elites in these countries. But I have to say that especially after the migration crisis, this narrative, which perhaps used to be marginal, has become absolutely mainstream. So even liberal politicians in the Czech and also Polish, Slovak, Hungarian context, when they speak about refugees, for instance, they always have to start with, you know, this kind of ritual declaration that they are also against this kind of solidarity, but, and then they can add something. But, you know, so the situation is a very kind of tricky one with deeply entrenched kind of Eurosceptic attitude where solidarity plays sadly a central role, but a role that is rather negative rather than positive. So that's the situation in the Czech Republic. Of course, it's different in Poland and Hungary, where it goes also into the questions of rule of law, etc. But I think that this basic attitude is similar across the Visegrad Four.
Okay, Petr, sorry for just leaving the talk. I have some internet issues here. Anyway, that's the overall picture and the reasoning behind a more negative approach towards the aggregate concept of European solidarity. But then there are, of course, developments where countries help each other. And I think also the Czech Republic has been benefiting from this help. Take the Chinese issue with the pressure on the Czech Republic from China, where the other European countries were outspoken to help the Czech Republic. Take the extra doses of the corona vaccine for the Czech Republic when it was very, very much affected with a very different, difficult and serious situation. Take the security diplomatic role with Russia, or the tornado where also Austria tried to help. Is this perceived as bilateral, trilateral help? Does anyone talk about European solidarity in that respect? That's my first question. And the second, no, okay. So that's something between nation states, no?
Exactly.
And then my second question is, do you expect any change with the new government?
Yeah, well, thanks for the questions. I mean, the first one, clearly, of course, it is a kind of solidarity, but you know, it depends on the framing by the media and the political elites. And typically, the example you gave with Russia, I mean, the prevailing view today, probably in the country among the population, would be that the European Union did not really support the country in the conflict with Russia. There was very few countries that expelled their diplomats together with the Czechs, right? So it really depends, right? Or the coronavirus vaccines, it would depend on whether you frame it as, look, others help us, or look, only very few others have helped us, right? And as I say, the populist instinct of the previous government would be rather to stress the negative side rather than the positive one. And frankly, the new government clearly is not as populist as the previous one. That's quite clear. But it is the old political parties, right? It's not a new force, some fresh air. It's the parties against whom Babiš's government came up with his revolution, right? So we are coming 10 years back, we are not going to the future. And as you know, the Czech Republic before Babiš was, President Václav Klaus, was as Eurosceptic or even more Eurosceptic than under Babiš. So frankly speaking, I'm quite skeptical in terms of a U-turn towards more constructive, engaging EU policy of the country. So yes, there is clearly a change, but in terms of how solidarity is perceived, especially when you talk about economy, the Eurozone or the migration, I think there the new government is even more skeptical than the previous one. So no, I think these are just general constants in Czech politics.
And are there any generational differences?
Absolutely. There is a change. Clearly, the Pirate Party, which is in the government, will be in the new government, is a representative of the younger people. And clearly, on some specific policy issues, there is a change. Climate change is the first that comes to mind. But among the five parties, the Pirates are the weakest. So again, there is a representation, but we really cannot expect a paradigmatic change of Czech politics.
Evolutionary then, hopefully. Exactly. Ignacio, Spain is a very different case in point. There's a big contrast between what we have just heard and the public perception of European solidarity in Spain. I remember the slogan that Spain is the problem, but Europe is the solution. And I wonder, where does this very, very positive perception of European solidarity come from? And is this changing now over time? Has this changed?
Well, thank you, Paul. Yes, it's really different, the perception on the topic from the point of view of Denmark or the Czech Republic, to a lesser extent, also Austria when compared to Spain. And by the way, I have to start by congratulating the editors for the topic you have selected for this volume, because it's really interesting from the point of view of the national narratives to the European Union, perhaps. This idea of solidarity is one of the most key to contrast the how different national perspectives towards European integration are so different. I was listening to before answering to your question, I was listening to right now to Petr, probably he doesn't know, but what's interesting that in the first lockdown, March 2020, when Spain and Italy were hit so much, that I think Spain asked for assistance, for solidarity to other member states. And I think the Czech Republic was the first to answer to that call, I have to say. But interestingly, the Czech government preferred to donate medical material through NATO, not to European Union. But was assistance to a NATO ally, a NATO partner, not a member state of the European Union. So from the point of view of Spain, and considering, the political prestige of European Union as a political body of solidarity, of wielding a political community compared to NATO, which is a security organization, it's very interesting that for Spain, the real political community in which we are trying to be a fellow countrymen in the future, to will a demos, to will some kind of federal union, is the European Union. And this is very important to see how pro-European political elites and Spanish public opinion are, to understand how the concept of solidarity connected to the European integration is so important in Spain. You asked about if this has changed. It's changing. For example, as compared to again to the Czech approach, here solidarity is not a stigmatized concept. Is on the contrary, is a concept which is very used by, or used to be very used by, political actors, both in the left, of course, in the left, but also in the right. Connected to some tradition of Catholic thought about the need of having social cohesion, and welfare state in Spain is something which is of course is most supported by progressive political forces, but also normally Popular Party has never had a discourse against welfare state. But this is interesting because now with Vox this is changing, and for the first time We have in the Spanish political discourse a political party with if you look to the opinion polls, perhaps around 15% of of vote if we had elections. And they are basically on the public discourse talking about not being solidarity with in terms of migration, but also in terms of redistribution, internal redistribution. So this is a real change but traditionally, and you mentioned Ortega said at the very beginning, this idea that the solution to the Spanish problems are more Europe, is more Europe because we have to deal with so many problems, including our own debate about nation building in Spain, and Finnish nation building in Spain, that Europe is the solution to all that. It's the solution to our economic problems as relative backwardness, the solution to our problem of democratic consolidation, and the solution to our problem of even the national community. And 40 years after Spain joined, or 35 years after Spain joined the European Union, things have changed. But the narrative, the dominant narrative about that Europe is helping Spain, it's very connected to the idea that Spain has also to show solidarity to other member states in Europe, or to show solidarity in other domains, not only economic domains, but also, for example, during Brexit. Very interesting, the position of Spain during Brexit with Ireland, that we have to show solidarity with Ireland in the question of Northern Ireland, that we have to show solidarity during the pandemic in terms of vaccine. We have to show solidarity also with cohesion. Now that Spain is no longer the most important net recipient of European funds, we still have to show solidarity to those countries we are going to be recipient. Of course, you can imagine that there are also some selfish consideration on that. For example, the Spain is still a net recipient of funds for agriculture. But it's interesting that perhaps this dominant narrative that Spain is so pro-European, and that the European Union has helped Spain in so many domains, that the except for this new this new approach of Vox, all the other political forces and most of the Spanish public opinion still show this kind of support to the European Union, and the linkage between European membership with some kind of solidarity regarding the internal market, regarding the Eurozone, regarding migration, or regarding also legal judicial cooperation or the pandemic.
Ignacio, I was wondering, whenever I listen to the Spanish discourse, that the narrative of Europe is the solution somehow implies that there is Spain on the one hand and Europe on the other hand. But Spain is one of the biggest member states of the European Union. There's no decision where Spain doesn't sit on the table. Spain can actually steer the decisions in one direction or the others with its economic weight, with its political weight, with good arguments. And I'm wondering, with that narrative, do people really understand that Spain and the European Union are somehow the same thing, that Spain forms part of the European Union as an integral part? And do people not expect too much if they just say Europe is the solution? I mean, I always wonder, I mean, Spain, there's so many issues and problems that the countries have to solve themselves. You have on the one hand countries which would say, no, we just rely on the European Union and its institutions because they have a high level of credibility. And then you have others who would say, no, we just do everything on our own. We don't want to hear anything. Or if we help other European partners, we go via NATO, or we opt out from certain politics and policies. Don't you see the danger of this narrative as well?
No, absolutely. I mean, I'm trying to, and this is also in the chapter, when I try to analyze the different factors that explain why the Spain's view of European solidarity is so distinctive and is so high on the narrative of the European Union, the idea that the European community, the European Union, is also a community of solidarity. I mentioned three factors. The first one is that this high political prestige of the idea of solidarity, even in the domestic discourse. Second, how pro-European political elites and public opinion in Spain are. And the third one, and this is connected to your question, is this self-perception of weakness and this idea that Spain needs to be held by the European Union, and that, and more interestingly, that Spain is not a very powerful player in Brussels, which is absurd considering that Spain is the fourth largest member state. And of course has so many votes in the European Parliament, in the Council, influence in the Commission, but still the idea is a quite reactive and passive attitude. No, we are a member of the European Union, but in fact we are much more policy takers rather than policy makers. And it's true that this is dangerous, because in particular, if you have this perception that the country is weak economically, that the country is in the periphery, that the country is also weak in terms of the power itself of the Spanish diplomacy, Spanish negotiators, that we basically had to receive from the European Union. And this, of course, explains that you are in, if you think that you are weak and that of and as a result of this, you are going to receive more than you are going to give to others. It's obvious that this is a something which helps the idea of solidarity so important. But if you combine this idea that we are in favor of solidarity because we are weak and we are not an active member state, but a passive member state, and I'm talking about the dominant narrative in public opinion, in some political elites, of course, not in the on those who are negotiating in the working groups and the council, this is dangerous. Dangerous because this makes the country to be not a real player in how to shape the future of the European Union linked to it. But this is also changing, I think. The point, if you look to the 90s, 25 years ago, Spain were perhaps boxing above the wave of Spain at that time, in terms of trying to be proactive. Then, because of different crises, I mean, the economic crisis, migration, territorial crisis with Catalonia, political instability, now the things have changed, and perhaps polarization have an impact in the idea that Spain cannot be an influential player in Europe. Well, we have this narrative of a polarized country, of a weak country, and of course this weakens the position of Spain on that. And you're right, this is a quite interesting approach to the issue.
Well, I'm just a very modest observer with Spanish family at home, but I would say Spain is much stronger than the narrative tells the people.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But let me move over to you, Evelyn. What do you make of everything you have just heard? And my second question would be, how do you actually evaluate the performance of Austrian politics in terms of European solidarity? A question I have to ask, of course.
What questions? So first of all, after a snowstorm in Brussels, we just have the luxury problem that the sun is so intense here that it is hardly getting difficult to see you. To what I've heard right now, I liked very much the strong message of Pedro Sanchez, the Spanish Prime Minister. He repeatedly said, in the context with Brexit, but also even before and afterwards, I mean, if you want to be protected, you have also to protect those institutions who protect you. So always being very much aware, if you want the European Union to have solidarity with you, your problems, be it financial problems, social, whatever, there is the need to support the European institutions as such and to make them strong and to make them democratically strong. And I always liked very much, and I still like this message very much, because often those who are acting in a very nationalistic and selfish way on the other side just make those institutions weak from whom they expect support. And of course, this is a contradiction we all know, and insofar remarkable that you hear a prime minister saying it and really taking it seriously. I think, and this is for me as an Austrian, somehow remarkable what I hear right now, because in Austria, we always think we're David and we are small, and Austria is such a small country, and there is always the danger to be overheard and overseen, and we should give and we don't take something. And so somehow this is a narrative, of course, we see up to a perversive degree when we look at the arguments and we listen to the arguments that the Polish Prime Minister gave when he was coming to the European Parliament's plenary and acting in a very aggressive way and in a repeatedly way, I'm referring to Viktor Orban, about whom I know he always loves to come to the European Parliament because then he just can play his David. And then in the Hungarian TV, you just see Orban, who just showed this tiger, Goliath's European Parliament, that the small Orban was saying something. So somehow there is, I think in most member countries, this story, here we are and we are so small, and there is this Moloch, the European Union, and of course always leaving out that we all part of these institutions, and when they look like as they look like, it's because we made it as they are. And you can make politics with that, but that's something we all know in our everyday's acting. But it's also remarkable to hear these arguments from representatives from large countries. So Spain for us is a very big country. So, and of course they are heard, seen. There is a lot of Spanish track you can see in European politics. Austria, that's really a question. Of course, what can I say? This is a very poor and lousy performance. We're looking back, and I don't say that only because Kurz is completely stepping back from politics today. This is really a bad example to leave everything out what means solidarity. Solidarity with others when it's about vaccines, solidarity with others when it's about financial support, and therefore are also acting in a very, I don't want to say selfish day, way, it's simply a not wise way. How can you expect solidarity with your own problems and with your own situation when you just show to others, we leave you out? Whenever there's a way not to support each other, then we let you go. This was only and is only a very short-term politics made for Austrian citizens themselves. So somehow, of course, concerning the content, it's not good, but also concerning the long-term effects. And insofar, I can only say this frugal four story, I mean, it's not very good for the Austrian economy, as we're having so close relationships in a high percentage with Italy. So somehow in this regard, it was not wise to say that, but it's also not very wise to look what will happen to Austria in the long run. Maybe one remark I would like to put into this debate also on the table, right now really blinded by the light. Solidarity means more than countries are acting in a way of solidarity between them, so between Spain and Germany and Italy and Sweden and so on. It is also amongst the population themselves. So what I don't see reflected in European politics and also in the way of national cooperation acts, and of course also not enough in the institutional work, is the rich and the poor. I mean, we have the rich in Spain, and we have the rich in Austria, and the rich in Sweden and everywhere, and the poor as well. And I think this is really not reflected enough. So solidarity for me means far, far more than this national approach amongst member states.
I think that's also something which we see reflected in European policies, which have a much higher impact than just bilateral or multilateral cooperation. If you look at the Next Generation EU package, the European Green Deal, or at the joint vaccine procurement and many, many other areas, you see the European value added when all come together and reach consensus on those issues. And regarding the recovery fund and the Austrian position, I would just like to add that, of course, Austria benefits much more from this recovery fund than just the money it receives in terms of loans, because Austria, just like Denmark, for example, is in a small and open economy, which does 70% of its trade within the single market. So from the money that others receive and reinvest, Austria also benefits. And that's something which is probably not enough reflected, of course, in the political discussion at home, which are geared towards home consumption, I would say. But moving to Denmark, Catharina, what's your take on this? I mean, Denmark is also small, beautiful, and without any European influence?
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks for all the contributions here. I've been listening with great interest. Yes, it struck me the most is the many different contexts of solidarity and how we've used it differently in our interventions even. And I think maybe my remark here towards the end of the seminar would be to try to I think so many debates these years are becoming quite polarized and antagonistic quite quickly. And I think it's quickly for member states to be accused of being unsolidaric. The Frugals were often accused of being unsolidaric. And at the moment, there's a very, very sensitive debate going on in Denmark where with the minimum wage, with a new proposal soon coming out on an EU directive on a minimum wage, where Denmark is fiercely against. And hence, I think the only country being fiercely against and hence being accused also of being unsolidaric. But it's not so much because of an opposition to workers in other countries gaining access to a higher salary. That's not the reason Denmark is against, but it's because we have a system of how wages are settled in Denmark that is not by law, but by social agreements. So, but also here, we are being accused of being unsolidaric. And I think it's important to, in order not to have a self-sustaining and debate, which will only, polarize things even further, to really clearly distinguish between solidarity and then being in agreement on everything. Because I think in so many other respects, you could highlight how Denmark always is first in class on transposition of EU directives and the rule of law and so many other things where you could easily turn it around. So, and there's even, I mean, after the migration crisis, solidarity is almost getting a bad reputation in the EU, because I think it was Petr saying in the Czech case, that there's it's immediate the need to distinguish yourself from the need to be solidaric on migration in many countries, also in Denmark. So if we use it in too many contexts and become too focused on who's not solidaric in a given case, I think we risk having a self-fulfilling prophecy here. But I think on the bigger level, I think solidarity, there are also many positive stories to be told at the moment about EU solidarity. We mentioned Brexit before, but also the vaccine story that you also mentioned, Paul. So a bit more meta remarks.
But there again it is the systemic issue of a nation state trying to protect the system. And telling a story which is not the whole story, which is about reaching the possibility of having minimum wages in other countries. Petra, from your point of view, do you think there's a chance for a positive story about European solidarity in the Czech Republic?
Well, I think, and I would like to hope that even, you know, after listening to others, I realized that this book that will be soon out should be an obligatory read for everybody, because then you realize, you know, like because the narrative typically is that it is us against all of them, right? We are the exceptional victim, the only ones who are, you know, not really listened to, the only ones who are on the sidelines, the only one who cannot take part in the decision-making. And then you hear the same story in Italy, in Spain, in essentially everywhere, with the exception of France and Germany, perhaps. So and then you realize that it's not really us and them. So this, I think, is a step in the right direction, certainly. But really, for me, the big question remains in, as Deputy Regner said, I mean, there are free riders like Prime Minister Orban who, you know, misuse the system, but that can be done only as long as the system works, right? Even with the free riders. So the big question is how to turn that tide. And I think there is a lot of work for us to do in our Central European region in particular. So it's a long trip to go, but I'm still optimistic that it can be done.
Ignacio, how can we avoid that everyone is a victim of European solidarity and turn the narrative around and make everyone actually benefit and also perceiving the benefit of European solidarity?
I really think that it is very much connected to which is the political finalité that it's widespread in some particular member state. Because if you really think that the European Union is basically internal market, it's much more difficult that if you think there is a political will to will something which we can consider as kind of political union. But even when if you only consider the European Union to be an internal market, every market can also have redistribution mechanisms. So I really think that even if you consider the European integration process as something which is not very ambitious, and I really think that in the case of Denmark or the Czech Republic or even Austria, it's not so ambitious as we perceive from Spain, the future of the European integration. I really think that solidarity can be considered as something which is a key, which is necessary, which is not a bad word or something which can be considered or something that we can criticize. It is has to do with something that has been said, and I very much agree that the idea is not exactly solidarity among member states, among national capitals, but solidarity among peoples. If there is some forest fire in Austria or in Greece, that we feel concerned and that we want to help. If there is a new wave of the pandemic in Eastern Balkans or in the Baltic countries, that we are concerned. Not in terms of quid pro quo or pork barrel in the European Parliament or log rolling in the Council, but basically as something that we really feel that we share something with those guys. It may be just the internal market or something more, but I think that to change the focus from the national capitals and the national government to the peoples is the way to do that. And when you have an experience of exchange, experience of exchange in your case, you mentioned Erasmus some minutes ago, this idea of having that experience, Erasmus, or just it can be a virtual experience of empathy, I think that we can improve a lot of this problem of selfishness and thinking that all of us are in minority and all of us with fighting with all the rest of the union.
Evelyn, what would be your conclusion from what you have just heard? I think it's a good sign that the sun is shining in Brussels. It doesn't happen every day. So how can you make the sunshine for European solidarity? It's
hard to believe that there is sun in Brussels.
So I'm brief. Europe is the solution. We see the concept of member states is under pressure. I mean, when we look at several member states, and see how the democratic systems as such within member states are attacked. Judicial system, journalism, I mean, all those pillars of society, we see it's not only that we have to debate on the construction of the European Union as such, and it's going far, far deeper. And European Union is the solution means, hey, there is an umbrella, there is a roof, there are already structures we created that need, of course, to be improved, deepened, better coordinated. I mean, 100 things to do, but there is an offer and there is a solution also to member states struggling with their incapability to give an answer to the population at so many questions, and which make the whole antagonism on who is in solidarity with whom so visible. So when we just see member states, they don't get there, they don't succeed in getting the tax rate they need in order to have schools run in a way as they should run and give an answer to all questions of the future and everything else we need to adapt to the future, including digitalization, climate change, then we see, okay, we need the European Union. And this answer, of course, is not so much fun for prime ministers and political leaders who would like to show I'm the strong man and I'm doing the whole thing and it's not the European Union. So in order to be sovereign, there is this necessity to have the European Union as strong as possible. And this is also an answer to the solidarity question, because then it's easier to be to act in solidarity amongst each other.
Well, I would tend to agree. I think on the big questions, we have to make much better use of this umbrella, which is the European Union. And we have to make much better use of joint solutions to our cross-border challenges, climate change, health issues, economic interdependence, well-being. I think there are many security issues, there are many issues which we can only solve together. That's one takeaway from my side. The next one is, of course, what Petr said, we have to talk much more about it, and we have to act much more in terms of European solidarity. And maybe if we find the funding, we will translate the book into 24 or more European languages. Maybe that would be a good idea. And I like also very much what Ignacio said on the fact that it's not only about political infighting all the time and us against them, but it's about regional and people-to-people relations. In particular, when it comes to crisis situation, emergency help, that's something where it gets emotional, where people actually feel that there is help from the European level and from other countries as well. The economic side sometimes is just very, very abstract when we talk about billions of help, which is so important to help people, for example, which are in short-term unemployment. But still, I mean, when there's a firefight there's a wood fire near Austria, and you have other countries helping, that helps. Or when you have regional cooperation in terms of in the area of health between Austrian regions and regions in the Czech Republic, these emergency situations when we can get the better crisis management, in particular when it comes to Corona, I think that is very, very useful. And I think the Danish case is something which is also very similar to the Austrian case. You have this political infighting, this domestic political agenda, and then this European challenges, in fact. And there the discourse many times contradicts itself. And I think when it comes to the narrative, it has to be fact-based, and it has to be also a cross-border narrative. And I think this narrative is something that people can actually would actually understand. So more a better understanding, more knowledge about this, about the interdependence, and then also with a stronger European identity, which takes time to evolve, I think European solidarity will also be a concept which will not be as abstract as it might sound at the moment, but something very tangible and very concrete for people. Now, let me, at the end of our talk, just show you what the cover will look like. This is the book that will be out in the next weeks, European Solidarity in Action, not only in words, in action, and the future of Europe, views from the capital. I think the views from the capital are actually the key in order to understand each other better, but also to work on what Evelyn said, to improve the quality of the glue between us. And European solidarity is actually this very glue which we need for better European policies. Having said this, Evelyn, thank you very much. Catharina, great to have you. Petr, thank you for joining us from Prague. Ignacio from Madrid. All the audience out there, thank you for having joined us. And this is one of the very many discussions which we will have all over the EU and the countries beyond the EU, all over Europe. Keep discussing those issues, and maybe we just need a little more talk, but very importantly, a little more action. Thank you for joining us. Have a nice day and keep in touch. Ciao.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.